Coming up on this episode of DL Weekly, new leadership has come to the resort, Rise of the Resistance news, pumpkin spice items.
Olga wants more credit. Santa is coming to downtown. We talk about the first 100 episodes and more. DL Weekly starts now.
Welcome to DL Weekly, a podcast about Walt's original Magic Kingdom, Disneyland. We cover the latest news and information from the resort, test our skills at trivia, and have a discussion about the parks every week. We invite you to send in your feedback and stories. Our contact information can be found at dlweekly.net. Now sit back, keep your hands and arms inside the podcast, and enjoy this week's show.
Hello and welcome to this episode of DL Weekly for the week of October 2nd, 2019. I'm Teg Bushman.
And I'm Teresa Urban. We'd like to send a shout out and a big thank you to all of our patrons, including Megan A. and Chris S., for supporting the show. This support helps to make DL Weekly possible. Our patrons get some pretty nice perks like access to our Discord chat, live shows like this one, some DL Weekly swag, and more. If you'd like to learn more, head on over to dlweekly.net/support.
What a crazy month it has been. Someone from the podcast has been in the parks twice this month. We would could not have had such a great experience without the help of James, Mike, and Scott over at Concierge. They've made our trip truly memorable and hassle-free. If you want that same experience, head on over to concierge.com and chat with them about what your dream Disney vacation looks like. Maybe you're a Disneyland expert, want to check out Disney World, Disneyland Paris, Alani, or even a Disney cruise? Even better. They can help with all those. Remember that there is no additional cost to book through them, and you get a year of touring plans free when you mention that DL Weekly sent you.
Now let's get to the news.
Well, last week, there was a management shuffle in the Walt Disney Company, leading to a new president at the Disneyland Resort. Rebecca Campbell will take over for Josh D'Amaro, who is going to now oversee Walt Disney World. Previously, Campbell oversaw the Europe, Middle East, and Africa direct-to-consumer business. Michael Colglazier, once a president of Disneyland, will take over Disneyland Paris. This is only, like, a big news deal because of the fact that, like, some of these people were in these roles for a lot less time than they normally are. Usually when they're placed as like the president of a resort, usually it's like 4 years or something. And this has only been 2 years since they've made like the last change. The other big deal was the fact that
Rebecca doesn't really have a lot of theme park experience either.
I don't know. I really liked it. Seemed like Josh D'Amaro was doing a pretty decent job. Mm-hmm. Of course, he's going to Disney World. Some people that are Disney World fans are very happy that somebody from Disneyland is going to Disney World because they kind of need better leadership, it sounds like. Michael Colglazier, if you guys remember, also used to be president of Disneyland, I think before Josh D'Amaro. I think Michael Colglazier oversaw the 60th anniversary of Disneyland. So, I mean, these people are all like have been at Disneyland. It's kind of interesting to me that people kind of start at Disneyland and then they like move, like they move them to other places and then they don't, I don't know if they do as well or it, like it just, it's so different, I guess.
It's like Disneyland's the entry level position.
But, you know, one of the things that people were saying is that they really like that generally the presidents in the past that have been ahead of Disneyland, they had a lot of like experience in the parks, like they kind of worked their way up through the company. So they kind of had that experience. But this Rebecca Campbell does not have that kind of like experience because she came more from like consumer products. So going from consumer products to like running a theme park, they're kind of two different businesses. So it'll be interesting to see how this all works out. I hope she does a good job because I think everybody wants Disneyland to be successful. And hopefully Josh D'Amaro will be successful over at Walt Disney World. Of course, he's going to oversee the 50th anniversary of Disney World, of the Magic Kingdom over there. So that'll be a big deal next year. So, or year after next, I guess, 2021. So.
Well, this past weekend, Freeform aired a Star Wars Galaxy's Edge special that included some new information on the upcoming Rise of the Resistance attraction. There have been rumors that this new attraction could top 30 minutes. However, Bob Chapek, the chairman for Disney Parks, Experiences, and Products, stated that the attraction will be approximately 15 minutes. This is in line with other favorites like Pirates of the Caribbean.
Now,
could you imagine a 30-minute attraction?
Well, because the rumors, spoiler alert, for those of you who don't want to know anything about this attraction, we've talked about it before on the show, but basically, there's going to be multiple parts of this attraction. Mm-hmm. So I could see it being a 30-minute thing if, like, each part kind of took a little bit of time, you know? So it's not just... The way they're doing this is it's not just, like, one attraction. It's, like, multiple attractions kind of in one, which is what kind of makes it really interesting. I will say one thing that I'm already disappointed about with this whole situation is they showed some pictures of the, like, hangar bay that's inside that everybody's kind of shown where it's got, like, you know, all the stormtroopers and stuff.
Yes.
Hanging out there. Well, just like the Millennium Falcon, it looks like they also put some, like, guardrails up in front of them. And I'm like, there's never been guardrails on a Star Destroyer. Why is there guardrails in front of these?
Well,
it just takes it out of it for me.
Well, do you get out? And I don't get that.
I don't think you get out at that point. But, like, I don't know. Like I said, I'll see if I can find a picture here for you. Because I think it's silly.
So I was very curious because I was talking about, you know, 30 minutes, that'd be crazy. Well, then I kind of realized, I'm like, well, wait a minute. Well, how long was the Great Movie Ride? Because this
that was also a long
seems
attraction.
Like it's somewhat similar, right? You kind of like takes you through these scenes and stories. And I don't know. And there's going to be live
sure.
actors. I think maybe the live actors part
yeah.
is what makes me
I didn't
draw
think about
a parallel
that, but that's
to
good.
The two. But so according to this, the Great Movie Ride duration was actually 22 minutes. So really 30 minutes wouldn't be that far-fetched for this. So I don't know. I'm curious. I mean, I'm going to go with the man that's in, you know, has the know and knows way more than we do. We can only
right.
speculate. But so if he says it's closer to 15, maybe it is. But
well, because his comment was something about like how intense it's going to be chased around by Kylo Ren for 15 minutes. So that's kind of like he didn't say like it's 15 minutes. He just said
sure,
like you're going to be
sure.
chased. But do you see this picture? They've got like this rail like you've seen Star
oh,
Wars. There's nothing like that in Star Wars. And the attraction, this is the trackless vehicle portion of the ride. So it's not like people get out here. So I just feel like to me, this kind of like takes me out of it a little bit, but I will wait. I will
They're
see how the attraction
pretty well. It's not very obvious that this is a fence.
Yeah, I suppose. It just looks to me like I don't know. I expect it to be more open because in Star Wars it's all open. There's no handrails.
Maybe it will make more sense when you are experiencing the attraction.
Maybe. I think 15 minutes is a good ride duration, though, because, you know, like Millennium Falcon Smuggler's Run was like, what, like 5 minutes maybe in the attraction, maybe less. So I do like the fact that you have a longer attraction. Hopefully, with the 15 minutes, hopefully it'll be like Pirates where they can chunk, you know, pump people
Get
through
people
there pretty
through.
Quick.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, apparently Oga's Cantina has been so successful this summer that Disney has decided to raise the prices of some of the items. All of the alcoholic options have increased by about $1, and the popular Ranker Beer Flight has increased by has increased a crazy $10 to a total of $85.
Crazy. You know, I thought that the pricing was a little high.
Mm-hmm.
For Disney, in my opinion. So it's crazy to me that they're going to raise it even more. But I think the crazier thing, because there's a whole lot of crazy with this, is that people will still pay it.
Yeah.
I mean, which is right, your choice. I'm glad we got the experience. I don't know necessarily if I have to go to Oga's every trip that I'm there. Because it was just a little frustrating, like a little annoying, a little frustrating to me that we had to have like a reservation and you couldn't just go in there, which I get, you know, it's not that
big. The reservation was the least problematic thing for me. I think the most problematic was the first night we were there, I felt like we had okay service.
Yeah,
like
it was good the first night.
It was good, but like I still felt the service was a little slow. Like she could have come back more. The second time we went, the service was awful. Like she never like came. Remember, we were trying to get her to come back to order a second drink, and I'm pretty sure we were there more than 45 minutes that we were supposed to be there.
Oh, yeah, no, we were there because we checked.
I also think
which was weird because nobody said anything to us and like told us that we had to skedaddle.
I also think that it was, and I know it's supposed to feel like this, but I thought it was too loud. Like I don't like being in a loud atmosphere where I have to like yell at you. But I get it's supposed to be like a bar and a club, and like bars and stuff are loud. I get that. I guess. I don't know. They need to do something. Something, they need to jigger something in there. I don't think raising prices of the drinks is what they have to do.
I wish that they had more like food and snack options instead of just the two that we had tried.
Well, hopefully once Rise of the Resistance opens, hopefully the land will be a lot busier and they will put the restaurant that they were supposed to have with this.
That would be nice.
There. Because I think that's what's needed is like a themed restaurant. Can you imagine like a Blue Bayou in Star Wars?
Like not really, but it would be interesting. Well, like, I don't know how you would do that, but I think that'd be cool.
But you could have, you know, like Epcot is going to have that space restaurant that's going to be by Mission Space, yes, so you feel like you're in a space thing. Mm-hmm. You could do something like that for Star Wars where you feel like you're getting launched up and maybe you're eating like on, you know, in a, you know, a mess hall of something or on some type of ship.
Hmm.
And then you could have characters come around, like Admiral Akbar could come around and say, well, he's dead, I guess, in the time frame right now. But but you could have like Chewbacca come around or Poe Dameron come around.
Or
like
BB-8.
you could make it a character dining experience.
There you go. There you go. If you are a member of the LGBTQ community or an ally, this weekend is the annual Gay Days at the Disneyland Resort. The weekend kicks off on Friday afternoon at the Welcome Center located in the Trillion Room at the Grand Californian and runs through Sunday at 8 p.m. Saturday is the main event with Gay Days at Disneyland all day. Remember to wear a red shirt to show your support. On Sunday, it's Gay Days at DCA from 8 to 6. For more information on all the festivities, because there are a lot of them, check out GayDaysAnaheim.com.
Now, I might have gone to two Gay Days in my time. I know for sure I went at least to one time. And it was fun. It was great because you see people that are part of the LGBTQ community. You see a lot of people who are just allies of the LGBTQ community. Everybody's wearing red shirts. Everybody's there to have fun. You know, there are a segment of people that kind of stay away for this weekend because, you know, they don't agree with it or whatever, which is fine. It's good that it's publicized like this so people that don't want to have to, you know, do anything with it don't have to. But it's great to see so much support in the parks for this. Disney's actually every year has gotten more and more kind of merchandise and stuff that they have for this, because the reason that they had to have this and it's put on by a separate group is that Disney didn't really want to support it, and they didn't want to like have, you know, theme days like this. Like, they also don't put on Bats Day that comes up too. So it's kind of nice that like
Dapper Days.
Yep. So it's kind of nice that they're having this. Again, it's this weekend. For those of you, I'm sure those of you that care about this probably already know that it's always the first weekend in October. And it's kind of fun. It's nice to see everybody. They do a giant group photo. They have a lot of different like Imagineers and stuff come and talk, and a lot of that stuff's done at the hotels. So they have a lot of cool stuff. So even if you can't make it into the park, if you're in the area, I would recommend stopping by one of the hotels because they have like the Welcome Center, and they do have some various activities going through that are either a small fee or totally free. So if you're in the area and this is interesting to you, I would suggest stopping by. Well, it's that time of year again when everything that can be pumpkin spice is pumpkin spice. This time, the beignets are getting the pumpkin spice treatment. As usual, these are available at the Mint Julep Bar in New Orleans Square and are $5.49 for a pack of three. The main difference with this variation is the spice is mixed in with the powdered sugar and not baked into the beignet itself.
Interesting.
So I wonder if this just makes it easier because then they just make
beignets.
One set of beignets. Yeah. And then if you want the pumpkin spice one, they roll it in the one sugar. If you want regular, they roll it in the regular powdered sugar.
Interesting. So I feel like I've failed because I have not tried a Mickey beignet. We have tried the mint juleps, though, but I'm not a big pumpkin spice person myself.
What type of beignet did we have? Didn't we have a beignet or something?
I didn't have a beignet.
Didn't we get beignets? We got beignets that morning. We got beignets the morning that we got the two drink julep things. Because I had a cold bites and I gave it to Vern.
I didn't have one.
Oh.
Okay, you had a beignet. I did not have a beignet.
Because I always get beignets.
Yeah, I fail, apparently.
It was good. Their beignets are good. They're nice and fluffy. They're like a light donut.
Oh, I've heard great things about them. I just, for whatever reason, just don't think about it.
I didn't think about getting the, I didn't get the Monte Cristo. Should have got the Monte Cristo.
Well, it's just for next time. Back to it.
Oh, sorry.
I'm not a big pumpkin spice person, but this actually sounds kind of good to me.
I need to try some more pumpkin spice stuff because I think the last time I tried a pumpkin spice thing was like forever ago.
Well, even more Haunted Mansion merchandise has come out this week. This time, you can get a diorama of the attic or seance circle areas of the attraction. The diorama includes walls, floor, props, and more. They have the feel of dollhouse props and are priced at $24.99 each. So these actually snuck out a little bit sooner because I actually showed Tag. I took pictures of them. They were in the World of Disney the last day that I was at the park. So that was last Tuesday. Mm-hmm. They were at World of Disney. So maybe they just creeped into the park this week. I was shocked. I would have bought one, but I wasn't very excited about the dioramas, which were just the attic and the seance room. If they have the hitchhiking ghosts or like the ballroom or the graveyard, I would have been all over that. But I'm very excited at the price point. I think $24.99 is great for these.
So did this seem to you like when you looked at them? Because to me, they look like you would make like a dollhouse, like you'd furnish a dollhouse with these props. So I guess I was looking at it. I thought they were kind of neat, although I didn't understand, like, I guess the use case. Like, is it just to have like a little diorama set up like sitting on your shelf or something?
So.
Okay. I was just curious because I thought they were neat. I just didn't really understand like what they were kind of going for, I guess. Well, it is barely October. In fact, we're recording this on October 1st, so just barely October. And Halloween is still a month away, but we're skipping Halloween and Thanksgiving and jumping right to Christmas to talk about having breakfast with Santa at Catal in downtown Disney. Tickets are $89 per adult and $39 per child, ages 3 to 10, and includes a family-style breakfast, live entertainment, a photo with Santa, a personalized stocking, and stuffed animal for each child. It is served from 8:15 a.m. to 12:45 p.m. on select days in December. For more information and to make a reservation, check out the link in our show notes.
That's very exciting, but I'm also very sad that we had to talk about Christmas already.
Well, last week we talked about making reservations for Thanksgiving dinner.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's at least next month.
Yeah, I suppose.
So but, we still have two holidays in between now and Christmas. But I get it, because if this is something that you're interested in, tickets for these type of events usually sell out pretty quickly, so you do have to plan ahead quite a bit.
What do you think about breakfast with Santa?
That doesn't excite me. However, I didn't tell you this yet. I got really excited at the personalized stocking part because I bought a stocking in Disneyland and had them embroider my name on it. So I thought that was very cool. So I think that's cool that they're doing something similar to that for this party. Plus, they get a little stuffed animal. I think that's neat that you get a stocking and a gift.
Well, you're meeting Santa, so he's going to give you stuff.
I know, but still, it's usually stuff like this is candy or food.
Yeah.
So I think it's cool that it's an actual gift.
For $89, I think, and $39 per child, I think that like, they got to do something. I actually like the story you're going to read next. I think that's a better deal, personally.
Well, if you're looking for more of a budget-friendly event, Ralph Brennan's Jazz Kitchen will be hosting a holiday gingerbread workshop. This event is scheduled for 3 hours and includes a brunch buffet from 11 to 12:15 with unlimited soft drinks. After brunch, Executive Chef Darren Finkel will help you build your own gingerbread house. Tickets are $52.55 per adult and $31.33 for kids 3 to 10. If you have the best decorated house, you can win a $100 Jazz Kitchen gift card. A pro tip for this, you can bring in your own decorations to have a leg up on the competition. For tickets and dates, visit the link in the show notes.
So the first thing I want to say, the weird pricing, the $52.55, that like includes all the like taxes and everything.
Oh, okay.
So that's why it's like weird numbers. I like the idea. First of all, $52.55 and you get this gingerbread house and like this jazz kitchen kind of like brunch buffet. I think this is a great deal and you get to make this thing and you have a chance to win a $100 gift card.
Plus you have an executive chef there to help you.
That's true. Now I thought that was funny because the person over at Mouse Planet where I saw this posted had the tip that people were bringing in their own decorations. So you're not limited to what, because they'll give you decorations to decorate it. But if you want a chance to kind of win this $100 thing, you probably have to go a little above and beyond. So people actually were coming in with their own stuff. And those were the people that generally were winning because they were going kind of above and beyond than the basic stuff that's there.
I want to see pictures of these.
Well, I'm sure that we will once it happens. So I guess because they have a few different days that they do it. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we'll have to see. But for 3 hours and you get the brunch and you get to have somebody help you build your gingerbread, I'd be all about this. Well, sometimes there are projects at the resort that take longer than anticipated for no obvious reason. One of these projects finally is nearing completion is the entrance to Adventureland. The new entrance sign has been in the works for months now and is getting one of the final touches this week. On the right side of the sign, a new tiki hut has been added that is similar to the hut that was there previously. More landscaping and some added props should finally complete this change.
So this is mind-boggling to me because literally I was there a week ago, standing at this sign a week ago from today as of this recording. There was no hint. It looked exactly the same as when we were there a month ago.
Right.
There was no hint that there was any progress really being made. So when I saw the photos, I was like, holy cats, like it
did
looks
you say
so
holy cats?
I did say holy cats.
Okay.
Holy Disneyland cats. anyways, it didn't like it. They did. It feels like to me that it's took forever, forever, forever. And then boom, here it is.
Mm-hmm.
So
It looks interesting because awesome.
I feel like they're going to fill stuff in a little bit more because it's very open looking.
Yeah,
right
if
now.
You look at an old picture, like it was a lot more like kind of down to earth kind of a thing. This seems very high. So I hope they do something.
Maybe that's some of the landscaping. Maybe there's going to be like bushes and stuff.
I'm glad that they're finally finishing up. That's all I got to say. And I'm glad that the sign came back. I knew the sign was going to come back. I know some people were worried about it. I'm glad that they figured it out. So.
The monorail has finally resumed all-day operation on a daily basis. The monorail had been operating only in the morning and evenings because of the heat of the middle of the day for much of the summer.
You know me. I'm happy that the monorail is back to full operation. They need to do something because I don't like the fact that they keep having to do this. So they need to do something. I don't know what, but they need to do something.
You know, this is side note related, kind of not related. So when we were there Tuesday, my family went and did the magic morning. And with the annual pass, of course, you don't have magic mornings. So my parents and I took an Uber over to the resort later. We got dropped off over at the Disneyland Hotel so I could show them more of that side of the park in downtown Disney. We had breakfast at Earl of Sandwich, and I looked at them and said, hey, do you guys want to ride the monorail into the park? They had like mind blown. They did not know that was a thing. That was a great, great, great experience, by the way. Going, getting dropped off on the Disneyland Hotel side. There was nobody in the security line when we walked through, so we just breezed through security, went and got our breakfast sandwiches. No big lines waiting to get through the turnstile and get your ticket scanned in for the monorail. It was like we had like a backstage pass or something. It was very cool. And then that afternoon, we decided to take the monorail back over to downtown Disney. The whole family did, and we had lunch at Earl of Sandwich again. Apparently, we're big, big Earl of Sandwich fans. I've had it only 4 times in my life. 3 times was on this last trip. But
you had
it very
three times
good.
In the like 4 days.
Three times,
you were
there? Twice for breakfast, once for lunch.
Wow.
I'm gonna blame Richard. He's created a monster.
I mean, it was good.
It was
really good. Enjoyed my
the
sandwich
breakfast
there.
Was awesome. And
so you didn't do Starbucks for breakfast, huh?
I got Starbucks too.
You've got a problem.
I need my caffeine. But anyways, so I kind of warned them because I was a little surprised that it was that the monorail was still running midday. Last week, because Tuesday was pretty hot, but it was not pleasant in the monorail. So yes, I do hope that they can get the air conditioning fixed or maybe just get better fans or something, because we were riding it with the windows down and it was still pretty toasty in there. So I can just imagine the middle of Southern California summer, middle
like
of the day
some
would
of those
just
days
be
when we were there.
Whew, would just be mm-mm, no thank you.
I will say that Disney's figuring something out because the Skyliner, like the gondola system that's over in Disney World, just opened a couple days ago.
Yeah.
And their ventilation is working great, and they don't have air conditioning in those gondolas, and that was one of the big things. The only thing I heard about it, for those of you who may go to Disney World at some point, is that if they do have to slow or stop the gondola, it does get kind of warm because that air, because the way it works is they've got the vents open and it kind of vents through.
Sure.
But I don't know. I watched multiple videos online of this and I really want to experience it. But anyway.
One day, someday.
Well, now we take a trip to Trivia Land where producer James tries to stump us with some Disney trivia. He'll read us the question. We'll attempt to answer them. And James will give us the correct answers after the discussion topic. What do you have for us this week, James?
Well, I am trying to follow through on your request, and I am asking you trivia about the podcast in honor of this being our 100th episode.
Trivia about the podcast. Okay.
And let's start with me being a little vain. On what episode, or I should say, what episodes did producer James and producer Vern debut?
Oh, boy.
Like together or just?
No, separate. We've never been on we've been on one show together,
I feel
but
like
never
this
interacting
is
together.
Cheating for me because we talked about this. I asked you when the first thing was, and I thought it was like episode 45 or something.
Oh, that.
I have to know episode numbers.
Episode 45 was the trivia debut. I'm talking about us debuting on the show itself.
Oh,
period.
I will accept episode numbers or episode titles.
Oh, man.
I'm going to say episode 9, because I think it was in the first 10, but I don't think it was that early. So I think like episode 9 or something, because one of the days you couldn't make it or something. Or was it the episode, I don't remember what it was called, I will honestly. Was it the episode that you two both did it? Because I don't know what we were doing, but you two did an episode.
No, Vern and I have never done an episode together.
I've never done an episode.
I thought you did an episode together.
No, I've done an episode with Teresa, and I've done an episode on my own, but I've never done an episode with Vern.
It's got to be like the title had to be something Run Disney related. I don't know what the number is, though. It was a while ago, because it was when we were in the station over there.
Yep.
Before you moved our recording station to here.
Yeah, but I don't remember when we did that.
I'm going to say it was Run Disney related.
You've got a 1 in 100 title. Chance if you want to guess number.
I don't like those odds. Don't like those odds. And James, gosh, I don't remember. I don't know.
Did James premiere before Vern or after Vern?
I think before. But I don't know what my episode number is.
Just pick a number.
I'm not. He said or title.
Okay.
Question number two. What was the day that you two launched your first podcast together?
Oh, September...
20th?
You might be right. You're probably right. I'll go with September 20th as well. Boy.
Jumping on the September 20th bandwagon.
I mean, I could have, like, not be 2 seconds ago.
You don't look. Looked. Don't look.
Yeah.
But I didn't. And we're... Yeah, so I don't know.
All right. Question number three. Other than the tour of the park, what is the longest episode you've recorded?
Oh, other than the tour. It's going to be...
I like how you got so excited about
it's
that.
It's the...
We definitely had a guest.
It was just recent. Because it was like almost 2 hours or something, or it was a little over 2 hours or something ridiculous.
Did you get lazy editing?
No. Who was our last
guest? I'm
going to
say the genie.
Who
our
was
last our... guest was Tim, and before
Tim
that was Chrissy
Anthony. Long. I think it might have been Tim, because we had a long discussion topic too, or a long news segment.
I'm going with
no.
Team. Oh, there is a look
it
coming
wasn't
from
Tim.
You.
It was you and Alex and everybody in the park. So it was just a couple weeks ago. It was when you
last
were in the
week?
Park. Yeah. So it was the Oogie Boogie.
Oh, Oogie Boogie Bash.
Yeah, because I think. Yeah, because I remember going, wow, that's a really long episode.
Oh, I didn't think Alex and I talked that long.
No, but we had a long news segment, and then you added your part in there.
All right, question number four, and I do have 5 questions this week.
Oh,
boy.
How many episode titles relate to Halloween?
Out of the 100?
Yes.
7.
I was going to say like 12.
It is a popular topic for you two.
So just relating to...
Halloween or Halloween in the park.
Because our very
park,
first
yes.
episode
title.
Was Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The title itself, 7. not the
the title itself, yes.
I'm
yeah, I feel like
10.
You're just cheating at this point.
I'm just
10
looking
or 12.
At Halloween 10. 98.
All right.
Oh, and 99. So that's 2 right there. But I'm going to say 7. How 7. Many are you saying?
10.
10?
All right. And your last one. A little bit of rounding here. But what is the approximate total runtime of your first 99 episodes? I will accept minutes or hours.
Oh, boy. Can I use a calculator?
Of course you can.
98 hours. Because we had some really short ones in the beginning, but we had some longer ones later.
It's true.
So I'm going to say 98 hours.
Teresa's got a look.
You're at 148?
Like what I just mapped. That was way more than that.
Ooh.
I'm going to say 125 hours.
Oh, boy.
That's better than the 148
that's I don't know. What if you were closer with 148?
But if you look here.
It's the Price is Right. Closest without going over.
Hold on.
Stop cheating.
No, I just want to show you an example here. Oh, this doesn't have time run times.
Oh, darn.
But generally
no
like
cheating for you.
But in our beginning episodes.
Some of them were like a half an hour.
Some of them like our very first episode.
Your first episode was just shy of 17 minutes. So
it was a very painful 17 minutes.
What do you mean?
Everyone goes back and listens to
I
it,
know.
And it's great.
I know.
So this week for our discussion topic, of course, we have talked already a bunch of times about the fact that this is our 100th episode, and I cannot believe that we have done 100 episodes. I'm so glad that we were able to do 100 episodes, though, don't you think? Did you ever think we'd get to 100
crazy.
Episodes?
No. No. I remember when we got one of our first patrons, I thought that it must have been a mistake.
I'm sure that whoever that was.
I'm just in disbelief and in awe.
Who was our first patron? Do we even remember?
So I no, it was our first $10 patron. I thought for sure they must not have meant to do a 1 and a 0. They must have only meant to do a dollar. And our first $10 patron is still a patron. It is Miguel.
Oh, Miguel, that's right.
Yeah.
In fact, Miguel just shared in our chat a picture of his lanyard that he has a bunch of pins on. And one of the things we sent to the first, like, 2 or 3 people that were supporters of ours was a name tag that was a Disneyland name tag with their name on it. So
yep, they got an extra special thank you. Our first ever patron is also still a patron, and that is our friend Laura.
She was the first ever patron.
Laura was the first ever patron.
Thanks, Laura, for that. And she's still around. We must have done something right. So I would like to say, first of all, that it had to start somewhere. So I was actually surprised. I did not remember the first episode, really. So I'm gonna we're gonna put that in the episode right now. We're gonna put just the opening, what we're kind of talking about, and the intro music, which that surprised me the most because I did not realize that our intro music was quite
what it was.
What it was.
Just quite what it was.
So we'll play that now. Coming up on this episode of Disneyland Weekly, Halloween has come to the resort, we have the details, and we discuss our individual history with Disneyland. Disneyland Weekly starts now.
Your attention, please. The Disneyland Limited, now arriving. Passengers will stand by to board.
Hello, and thank you for tuning into this episode of Disneyland Weekly, episode one for the week of September 27th, 2017.
So raise your hand if you're happy that we don't have that intro music anymore. Both of our hands are raised.
Okay, I miss it so much.
You got to bring it back. Maybe that can be the trivia intro music.
Richard said not to turn it off earlier because
he was jamming
he
out to
with it. So.
It's unique. I think that came from... So for those of you that don't know, before the podcast, Tag did do a YouTube news update about Disneyland, also called, that was called Disneyland Weekly.
So ours was called Disneyland Weekly
so
we were
very original when we came up with the name for the podcast, but I think that was the music that was from your video
part
news
of it was.
Segment.
Mm-hmm. James, that's what you should have asked as a trivia question. You should have asked, when did we switch from Disneyland Weekly to DL Weekly? Because I don't remember that either.
That would have been a good one.
That was not that long ago.
Well, it wasn't that recent either, because we've been DL Weekly now for quite a while.
I think you might be coming up on a year.
Yeah. Over the course of 100 episodes, we've had a lot of cool guests, and I think that that's what we should talk about next.
Some of our
great guests that we've had on.
So some of the highlights for us for guests were I think this is a good place to start. The 50th episode, since that was just 50 episodes ago, we got to chat with Lynn from The Sweet Spot. We got to chat with him about working the 50th anniversary at Disneyland. I thought that was really cool.
Do you know what I finished just today?
Ooh, the second book.
The second Sweet Spot book.
Good for
cleaning
you.
Cleaning the Kingdom.
Day and night.
Yep. And it was good. It was good. I enjoyed it. The first one was also great, so it was nice to kind of, they actually added, I can't remember if they had this in the first book or not, but in the second book at the end, they kind of have like a little biography of like their life and everything, and I thought that was interesting to read. I thought it was a good book. They have a lot of like codes in there, so I feel like I need to take the book with me to the park because it's got like all the radio codes, so you can tell like what they're saying with their like 10 codes and everything.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. But cool. I was very... Having Lynn on from The Sweet Spot for the 50th episode was one of the first times...
He was our first big guest on the show. Mm-hmm. We were very excited to have him on. Tag was getting all like fangirly.
I was. Now, the second person that we got on that I thought was a big, big deal to me was Alex from Star Wars Explained because he has a ton of viewers and subscribers on YouTube. Mm-hmm. And the fact that like, I mean, like, I feel like 1% of his audience is like our whole listenership.
Yeah, yeah.
So the fact that he would take time to come on to our show, and of course, he came on and talked about Galaxy's Edge, and that was really great. And we really thank him for that because, again,
that was
somebody
amazing.
That already has like a ton of stuff going on with his own stuff was able to come on and be on our show. In fact, all of the people that have other things going on, we're very happy that they were able to come on the show. So
going on with people that authored different Disneyland books, I really enjoyed talking with Rand about his book, Elbow Grease and Pixie Dust. Again, it's another book about a cast member's time at Disneyland.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was interesting, though, because it was very similar to the Sweet Spots book, but also very different, because both were kind of custodial themes, but very different areas of custodial,
like,
and written very differently. Yeah, written very differently, but kind of more behind the scenes. And I don't know, just very, very cool. I found it very interesting.
Yeah, I feel like between the Sweet Spot or the Cleaning the Kingdom book and Elbow Grease and Pixie Dust, I feel like I learned a lot about working at Disneyland without actually having to work at Disneyland,
Definitely.
Which was awesome.
Definitely.
Of course, another person that we had on that I could not believe came on our show, and somebody just filled out a survey, and they actually came from, they heard about us through Fresh Baked, is we had David from Fresh Baked on, and Teresa actually saw him a couple times in the park, like at things, like you didn't really talk to him, but you saw him.
Not at the park. I saw him at D23.
That's right. Mm-hmm. But then you showed up in his video. You pointed yourself out.
So they went to the Oogie Boogie Bash the same night that I was there with Alex. And if you watch the video while they're filming the Frightfully Fun Parade, you can see Alex and I kind of kitty corner across the street from where they were. So I had to take a screenshot and show tag because they had actually posted a photo on their Instagram. And yeah, you can see Alex and I, you can see Alex clear as day because he was dressed up as an old man. He was Mr. Fredrickson from Up. I was wearing all black with like potion purple ears. So I do not stick out like a sore thumb like he does, but I'm just to the side of where he was. So I like laughed so hard when I saw that. I thought that was so funny because I didn't see them and they were right across from where we were. So
he also was one of the few people we've talked to that actually stood up for the Autopia.
He loves the Autopia. He loves the Autopia.
Even the most, you know, the attraction that you think is the worst, there are 10,000 people who think it's the best.
Yeah.
So anytime
I would like to meet these Autopia fans because
I am one right here.
There are you really? Oh,
perfect.
Answer this long question for me. What is it about the Autopia that sparks joy for you?
It's the history. I feel like I am in Walt's presence when I ride. It's just what it means to the park, and I don't care that it's a noisy 8 mile an hour thing that doesn't actually do anything. None of that matters, and it shouldn't, because I'm not at the park to be thrilled in the contemporary sense. I'm at the park to feel that whatever Disney feeling that we often can't describe, which I'm having a hard time doing as we speak.
Well, it's indescribable.
That's perfect.
Right.
Yeah.
But that is one of the homes, that is one of the places where you can get that I cannot believe I'm in Disneyland right now feeling.
But great guy. It was so interesting and so fun to like hear him talk about Disneyland and his passion for the resort. Plus, he's very passionate about Fresh Baked and he really enjoys putting together those weekly and daily videos. Uh-huh. He goes to the park every week. He puts out videos daily. Uh-huh. It's definitely a labor of love. I think it's awesome.
I don't know how he finds the time to do that because he has a day job.
Mm-hmm.
And he puts out these videos.
Yeah.
And he does live streams every week.
Yeah.
He does busy. He doesn't just do a daily thing. He does the daily videos, but then he has a second channel that sometimes he puts like other things. I just don't know how he has time. It's just ridiculous.
Very passionate.
Definitely. We also had Fred from Touring Plans on. Of course, we talked about how Touring Plans kind of works, their data. I believe Fred was the one that told us about how the fact that like that Disney like manipulates the like return times at attractions to get people to move to different parts of the park, and their data contradicts sometimes what the standby times are for things. So I thought that was fascinating, and I still think the whole Touring Plans thing is fascinating. When Chris was on, he said that there was a lot of interesting things that sound a little shady to me, that like Disney will manipulate their wait times to get crowds to flow in different directions and stuff. Can you talk a little bit about that, or do you know anything about that?
Oh yeah, that's something. So when we collect the wait times, I'm really talking about what we call the posted wait times. Mm-hmm. So either there's a cast member outside the ride with a sign, or there's a digital sign or a manual sign posted at the attraction. So that's the posted wait time. But then the actual amount of time that you're going to wait in line is something else. It's usually less than that. Mm-hmm. And Disney does this for several reasons. One is they want to give themselves a bit of a buffer in case something goes wrong, or maybe there's an unusual number of wheelchairs that have to be loaded in.
Like when you go to a restaurant and the host tells you, oh, it's going to be 20 minutes for a table. And when they get you a table in 10, you're really happy.
Well, exactly. So customer experience is another reason why they might do this. But the third reason is that, and we particularly find this at the end of the day, they want to discourage you from getting in line, right? So if there's a, say that they're expecting there's going to be a mechanical problem that's going to, put the ride down for a short amount of time, they might jack up the wait time to try to discourage you from getting in line and therefore encourage you to come back later. Well, if you're coming back later, you're more likely to have a meal, go shopping, experience something else, Mm-hmm. And, you know, you're going to extend your day at the park. So there's that manipulating. I mean, I guess it's kind of manipulating, but I don't necessarily see it as manipulating in a bad way. I think it's, you know, it's a way to, you know, improve your experience. I'd rather they post 45 minutes and I only wait 30. I think that's actually a good thing.
Well, the nice thing too is, I mean, think of 30 minutes versus 45 minutes. That extra 15 minutes feels like an eternity, especially when you're in a queue and the line is not moving at all. There's several attractions I can think of that the wait time probably isn't actually that bad, but it just feels like it's forever. Mm-hmm. So I would rather walk by and see like, oh, 45 minutes and kind of be on the fence of it and then feel good about my actual wait than be stuck there for even longer.
Yeah. Oh, that's yeah, for sure. This becomes a bit of a problem for us on the mathematical side of things though, because you know, we have to convert all of these posted times into what we think the actual time is going to be. And, you know, it's complex. Like, it depends on the time of day. It depends on what attraction you're talking about. Some attractions, the posted time is a lot more accurate, if you want to say that. On others, they, you know, that the ratio of the posted to the actual is expanded because either it's more susceptible to breaking down or, you know, so there's a bunch of factors that go into predicting the difference between the posted time and the actual time you're going to wait.
We should try to get one of them on again because with the new Genie app that's coming out.
For Walt Disney World.
Yes, but I assume, I mean, they do stuff for Walt Disney World. So I'm trying to find out, it'll be interesting to find out like how their business is going to change.
Yeah, what the impact is for them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I got to talk about this. I feel like you're not going to really find any clips specifically of this because we talk about this a ton. I really always enjoy talking about the history of the parks, mm-hmm. specifically attractions, shows and parades. I really like digging deeper and learning more about the Imagineers behind some of our most favorite and most iconic things about the park.
Do you remember in our first few episodes, like you would come over and you would have like a notebook.
I spent so much time researching and I would, for whatever reason, I wouldn't type it in our script. I would handwrite it all. Mm-hmm. So I had this notebook that was full of all these notes about all these different things, all these fun facts.
Well, that's the whole thing, right? So in the beginning, like I would do some research and you would do some research and then we would come together and have like a show. Well, then I started getting busy and you would still do research, but I would not do research. I was just like, well, I'll just wing it. It'll be fine. And then like you'd have all the info. And you'd have it written down in this book next to you. And I'm like, can I see that for a minute? Because I need to get some information. So Teresa...
We did pass the book back and forth. And then finally I got better about just typing it into our Google document.
I will say the strength and weakness of the two of us together is Teresa is magnificent at deep diving into things and going and finding a lot of links and information
I'm
about things.
I'm great at getting down rabbit holes.
I am the opposite. I'm very good at, okay, I need to write a script and I've got like 20 minutes and I got to write the whole script in 20 minutes. So I just bang it out. Because there's been times where like you wrote one story and I wrote the whole rest of the script.
Yeah, there have been times that we've written the script side by side and it literally takes me the time to write one story and he's got seven it took me to do one.
But that's because you like to go get all the facts and all the information about it. And I just kind of look for the bullet points and I figure I'll just figure it out, right? So that's kind of what happens. So but people have told us like that's why we work well together. And I think that like together, that's why we're at 100 episodes. We work well together. We put on a good show. People seem to like it. So I think the next part, we're going to take a side trip and kind of talk about a bunch of things. Hold on. We're going to talk about some things together. Then we'll get back to another guest here in a second. But I think one of the things that we are known for is some of our
ridiculousness.
Goofs.
Yeah.
So the first clip, I'm not even going to say anything. I'm just going to play some of these clips back to back real quick, and then we'll talk about them.
The Pirates of the Caribbean attraction is now closed for refurbishment. Pirates will no longer be able to buy a bride because their auctioneer will be selling loot instead of ladies. The infamous redhead will be returning as a plundering pirate.
Well, the good news is that this isn't delaying the parking structure at all, because the parking structure is the thing that like needs to be done for Galaxy's Edge.
Yes, correct. And really, side note on that, the parking structure is going up at like crazy fast pace.
Yeah, it's looking good. Mm-hmm. So it'll be nice to see it completed, and I'm sure that people it'll be a breath of fresh parking air, if that's a thing.
I know, this is such a bummer, and you know, there's so many people throwing so many fingers, you know, saying it's Disney's fault, it's the city's fault, it's
okay. So the first clip you heard was Teresa. I did not hear this at the time of recording.
Yes, the best part about this is that neither of us realized that this blooper had happened, so it fully made its way all the way through editing, all the way through
and
to the finished
product.
And I had
to put it on the show.
And then while I think you were like finalizing everything, realized, oh,
but
you did not say plungering.
Plungering.
I can't say the word. Maybe it's just a me thing.
Plundering. So plundering pirates.
I can't look at it and say the correct word.
Sure.
Plundering.
Along the same time. So then we had the next couple of clips were actually like in the same episode. So one of them, I was making the joke.
Making
because,
up our own terms.
Because we were talking about the Pixar Pals parking structure. And I said that like, I was trying to make a joke or a play on words that like, it was going to be so nice for all this additional parking to open. And I said, it'd be like a breath of fresh parking air.
Hilarious. Yeah.
But then we were talking about how the City of Anaheim and Disney were not working well together. So Teresa, I don't know where she got this from, but she was trying to say fingers.
Yes, who knows?
And people were throwing fingers right and left. I think producer James even liked the throwing fingers one.
I think you
one.
And I were trying to be creative and just failed miserably is what I think happened.
Maybe.
Fell right on her face.
Maybe. So let's go back to another guest that we had that was really good.
So another very fun guest, and we were so super excited to be able to talk
Starstruck.
With him. Starstruck. And the cool thing too, I think, behind this guest is that one of our supporters actually knew this person and made the introduction for us, and that's how we got into contact with Dylan, who of course was the genie for forever and ever and ever. He
of Aladdin
was,
the musical spectacular.
In our opinion, he made that show. If you would have taken the genie out of the show, it just would not have been as good.
Hands down.
He was so much fun to talk to.
It was amazing.
Again, very, very, I felt he was very, very passionate, truly loved what he did during his time as Genie for the parks. Very, very fun.
If you want to listen to a great episode of ours, go back and listen to episode 76, and that's the one with the Genie. It was, I love talking to him.
Yeah.
I still follow him like on Instagram. Mm-hmm. So I still like, I'm amazed that we were able to get in contact with him and get him on the show. Cause the genie was like my favorite thing about Aladdin Musical Spectacular.
And the thing that was amazing is we realized after talking with him and then after pulling up some YouTube videos that was specifically him playing the genie. Cause of course he wasn't the only person that played the genie. He was Tag and I's favorite genie. Mm-hmm. He was our favorite person to portray it. So that was just really cool. Very, very cool.
What
it was like Disney royalty.
Yeah, definitely. And he talked about some of the other people. Like, he was very humble.
Mm-hmm,
and he reiterated a lot during the episode that it's a group effort to put on that show. And that really all together they made the show a success. It wasn't just, I mean, people think of the genie as kind of the standout thing that kind of brings people back. But really, you all have to work together. And so that was really cool to hear. Now, we have had... speaking of like working together to make things happen, we've had guests on the show that are listeners because that's mm-hmm. part of one of our perks. And so some of the things that we've had. So one of the folks that we had Shelley on, and she talked about cast member feedback. And one of our listeners actually messaged in and said that that was one of their favorite things from the 100th. So from one of the 100 episodes we've done. So let's play that real quick. Shelly, thank you very much for being on the show this week.
Yes, thank you, Shelly.
And I'm sure our listeners we always love hearing stuff from cast members. So thank you for making the time to come on and share your magical moments. And you shared some really cool stuff with us. Like, I think that story of you and the young guest that you signed his autograph book,
yes.
I think that's something I'm going to remember for a long time. So thanks for sharing that with us.
Thank you for bringing that up, too. Because that makes me want to, when I'm there, because I'm sorry, but I do think that everyone kind of sort of takes cast members a little bit for granted, or maybe they're a little bit invisible when we're there because I get so tunnel vision and I'm just so excited to be there that maybe I don't recognize, you know, that I do thank cast members and all that sort of thing. But it makes me want to kind of just go like even more above and beyond and do more than just saying thank you to cast members to try. Because you're right, you spend your whole day trying to make someone else's day wonderful. So little small things that we do for cast members, I'm sure, go a long way for them too.
Right. And I challenge both of you when you guys are there in August, every single day when you're in the parks at the end of your day, to go to guest relations in either park and leave a cast member compliment.
I do that all the
really
time.
It really goes a long way. And it means a lot to the cast members who receive them and get a little bit of acknowledgement, like, hey, a week ago, you did this magical thing for this guest and they acknowledge that, like, way to go. It just makes them feel so much better and like they're doing a good job. So,
right.
To any of your listeners who don't do that, go ahead and do that and just make a little bit of magic for somebody else while you're enjoying the park.
Well, you know, and it's so easy to do now, too, because this last trip, I was trying so hard to try and remember the people that stood out, the cast members that stood out and did, you know, things really, either did their job really well or maybe they went above and beyond for us, trying to just remember their names. And all of a sudden it dawned on me, hello, you've got a phone with you. You can type this information in. You don't have to try and remember this person's name until you get up to the front. So I actually started like a little note tab in my phone for that trip and was writing down the different people's names and maybe, you know, because you don't have their first and last name. So I would say, you know, I don't know, Steven over in Adventureland or, you know, whoever.
Yeah, I make sure I write down the venue, the cast member name, the time, and like where they were at. So like for me, if I had something like, let's say I had the person who's, you know, who taking fast passes at Indiana Jones, I write, you know, Shelley at the, you know, fast pass taking place at, you know, 145 at Indiana Jones. And then even if they can't figure, you know, even if there's 100 Shelleys working that day, they could like narrow it down to who that was and get it to the right person. So we will definitely do that, Shelley.
Yes, definitely.
And then we actually had another listener call in and leave a voicemail, and he's actually a truck driver and he was a cast member. And this also has to do with feedback. So we'll play that right now.
Finally, it's been a couple of months, but we actually have a voicemail that somebody called and left with
us.
Yes. So this is from Michael, and he's got a great story. Again, this is from kind of spurred on between Shelley and Connie, both having these great stories of being a cast member. So he's got a story because he also was a cast member. So let's listen to that now.
Hi, Tag and Teresa. This is Michael, the truck driver. I was just listening to your most recent show about Shelley. I'm not sure if I told you this, but I was a cast member, and it got me feeling a little emotional. I thought I'd share a couple stories with you about me making some magic for our guest. I had two tour duties with Disney, one as a third shift custodial and one as a security screener. Well, when I was working with security, I had a husband come up to us and tell us that it was his wife's birthday. So being the people that we are, kind of goofballs, I got everybody in our security tent to sing happy birthday to this lady. Didn't think anything of it. We sing happy birthday a lot. But I got called into our manager's office thinking I did something wrong. I was really scared. And I got a certificate for a guest compliment. I was completely shocked. And a second time, I was also security screening, and I had this little girl in the Elsa dress come through our tent yelling at the top of her lungs, "I'm Queen Elsa of Arendelle." Well, I was feeling like a goofball, so I said, "Welcome, your Majesty," and I did the big, deep bow, and her face just lit up, and she ran over to me and gave me the biggest hug, and it just made me feel all warm and gooey inside. So, like Shelley said, guest compliments do go a long way. Their cast members are really special people. I'm not saying that because I was one, but guest compliments do go a long way, and they do get to the cast member. Just like what Shelley said, try to get their name and their hometown. It has their hometown on their badge.
So again, just some really amazing examples of how cast members just really are the heart and soul of the park and really bring the magic right to the guests. And I'm so happy that these people, these guests that you did these little extra special things for, you know, kind of gave you some recognition and took the time to go talk to guest services and talk about how great you were and how you made their day special. And I'm also very happy that you got recognized by Disneyland. I think that's really great because, you know, it to some extent, it's probably an expectation that you guys do a little bit above and beyond for making sure that guests have a very magical experience. So it's great that they still, even though that's, I don't want to say it's part of your job, but, you know, even though it's something that's probably slightly expected, it's great that they still go above and beyond and give you the recognition that you deserve for it, and just don't ignore it and be like, yeah, thanks for doing your job. See ya. Yeah.
Well, a lot of people love the fact that we have talked about giving cast members feedback.
Oh, well, it's just, I think it's so important. And unfortunately, you know, as visitors to Disneyland and tourists, or however you want to explain it, or categorize yourself, you're in this Disney bubble. And so you think in the moment, wow, that was a really amazing experience. But I'm guilty of it too. I'm sure you're guilty of it as well, Tag. It's so hard to remember, wow, that was a great experience, and then to write a cast member compliment. I have started putting notes in my phone whenever something happens. I know Tag was taking photos of name tags, and of course we're explaining to them why we're doing this. We're not just coming up and like photobombing whatever. And yeah, it's so, so important. And I thought it was really cool because the last trip that we were there together, when we were there in August, we went and sat in City Hall because it was kind of a slower time during the day. We were in there for something else and decided, hey, we may as well just do these now. And just watching the cast member light up as we were giving the compliments, they weren't even compliments to her, but she was just very touched and just very grateful that we were taking time from our vacation to go ahead and do this. And again, you can do it at City Hall, but you can also go online if you forget to do it when you're actually at the parks, or you just don't have time to do it when you're at the parks. You can go online and you can submit your cast compliments online as well.
Yep. There's also, I saw somewhere, Disneyland was saying that another place you can do it, which may be easier for some of you, is if you're on Twitter, you can tag @Disneyland and leave cast compliments there too. So basically anywhere that somebody official from Disneyland can see something is a good spot to leave cast compliments. Something like Twitter, I think, is great because then other people get to see that there was these compliments too. Yep. Mm-hmm. So we did that quite a few times when we were there in the parks. Did you do any when you went for the Oogie Boogie Bash, or did you?
I did not. I have to go back.
Did you have anybody that was?
I didn't have anything that was super, super stellar.
Gotcha.
So I didn't have any like standout experiences. All the experiences were great and positive, but I didn't have any like truly magical experiences.
Sure. And then, of course, producer James came, and one of the things that was requested from us from a listener was to talk about the trivia about how many babies were born at Disneyland, so we will play that right now.
So as of 2015, how many babies are known to have been born in Disneyland?
In Disneyland.
Babies born in? I'm glad that question was not conceived.
I'll say five.
I don't think we'll ever get the answer to that one, Teresa.
Yeah, we don't want to know. All right, so how many babies were born in Disneyland? I was thinking 12.
12? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Right. Y'all way overshot this one. It's 3.
I was going to say it's probably like in 2015.
And so, James, let's talk about, so you said earlier, what episode did you start trivia?
Episode 45 was when we started.
Over half of the episodes we've done is now have trivia.
Exactly.
Some people wrote in and said that they really enjoyed the Trivia Spectacular, which I feel like we have to do again. I also want to do some type of trivia where you and I ask Vern and James questions, because they ask us all types of questions.
They
and I'm
do.
Really afraid. We have not had Vern on.
And I'm still afraid of that, too. I've been putting that off.
We're going to have to get him on soon.
Yeah, because the worst part about it is
those things that he counted, I don't remember anymore.
I don't know either, but I'm excited to see what they were.
He's got some good details for you. So I've seen some of his questions. It's going to be a rough time for you.
Oh, no. Just the joy that he was having coming up with these questions and finding these answers, and then the fact that he was pulling in other listeners to help him. I thought that was a really cool experience. I know Laura
really
had
cool.
a lot of fun. Yeah, really cool. loose air quotes
really
there.
Cool.
I do think it was kind of neat because he got Laura involved, Richard involved. Like,
but Richard
I said,
likes
I think
sending
it's just
us
very
trivia
neat.
Anyway.
I know, but they had a lot of fun with it. So I guess even though it's going to be oh so painful, because I think it's very difficult trivia. Very, very,
very
difficult.
Difficult.
I'll be impressed if we even get close type
you know what
of trivia.
I think you've already read them.
What?
The trivia from Vern?
I've read some of them. I haven't read the whole thing.
Because I was
going to
say, you should be on our side.
Oh,
it should be the three of us against Vern.
He's
but
like,
you've seen them now.
No,
I'm
going
to have to study.
I think I'm going to have a me day that night.
I'm just going to go through and read the rest of them to be safe.
So here's a question for you, Producer James. Do you have any memorable moments from the podcast that you want to share with all of the listeners?
I just think about a lot of kind of the behind the scenes things that don't necessarily make it out of the airwaves. Like you two are obviously laughing plenty during the podcast, but there's a lot of moments where it just kind of gets lost as well. And I think what's been really great about a lot of this from my perspective is like how humble you two have stayed throughout all of this. Like this has grown to way bigger than anything you've ever expected. And you've gotten opportunities. Like I think about Tag talking with Alex from Star Wars mm-hmm. Explained, something like he's like, I used to watch this guy on YouTube and like, he's super cool. And now I'm like talking to him, like these opportunities. And then you talk about Fresh Baked and the Sweet Spot and all of those. And it's just like, how cool that this crazy idea of recording a podcast in our basement has grown into cool opportunities for the two of you.
I will also say that this kind of leads into one of the things that Teresa had written down mm-hmm. As a highlight is meeting the Weekly Tiers, which are what we call people that listen to the podcast, Weekly Tiers. Meeting you guys when we got to go in August, and Teresa got to meet some more of you guys when she went last week.
Mm-hmm. And last year.
And last year when mm-hmm. she went. It has been amazing, and I think every listener that we met was amazing. They were so yeah. nice and generous, and they spoke so highly of the show. And, you know, when you create something, and Teresa is a good example of this because she hates the early episodes. When you create something, you kind of see all of the things that's wrong with it, right? So you hear all the like ums, or there was an episode I was listening to earlier when I was trying to pull a clip from it, and I was like, God, the audio on this sounds terrible, but nobody ever complained about it. So, you know, we notice things, I think, about the show and how we do things that I think that we're a lot harder on ourselves mm-hmm. about it than listeners are. And people are very happy with it. And I think the biggest thing beyond like the audio quality, you know, I feel like the audio quality maybe is what allows somebody to listen to a whole episode of ours, let's say. But from all of you guys that listen, everybody that we've talked to about the show has said that really it's our chemistry together. And our kind of personalities and how we do things, and we're kind of upbeat and everything. So that has been probably, I think, the friendships we've made in the community around the podcast, the people we've met that have their own communities but allowed us to kind of share in that a little bit has been probably one of the best things. I think I feel like we've made some friends through this that like we'll have even if we don't do the podcast anymore. I think there's some people we would definitely stay in contact with, and it's been great. Well, I don't know. What do you think?
Oh, definitely. The thing that was so amazing to me was the first night we went into the parks. It was Tag and I that Thursday night, right after we had just gotten off the plane. We had been traveling for hours.
Took a really long Uber ride through a lot of traffic LA.
Had to deal with LA traffic and rush hour. It was mm-hmm. it was a long day. And then we went to the parks and we met up with a handful of you there. And the thing that was so, so cool was some of those listeners did know each other, but not everybody knew each other. And just how everybody, that was one of the best nights I've probably ever had at the park. It was so much fun. Everybody got along so, so well. Mm-hmm. And we were relatively strangers when it first started, but we came out almost like family at the end. And that's mm-hmm. how I feel every time that we meet a Weekly Tier is, even though I may not know you personally, I'm still very excited to meet you. It was kind of funny. I haven't even told you this yet, Tag. No. Last week when I was there, I was with my dad and we were walking over in, we were over in Tomorrowland and we were kind of walking over by Autopia. And never did I think I would get this to this point, but I did with this Weekly Tier. I heard somebody call out my name. They said, Teresa. And I immediately just stopped and I turned and I said, hey. And she was a little caught off back. She's like, oh no, you don't know me. And I'm like, no, that's okay. And she's like, I'm a listener. You know, it was just really, really cool. And it was kind of funny because she was there with her mom and her sister, both adults. And they're kind of like, sorry. She like came to, I'm like, no, it's totally fine. Like I am excited. I'm probably just as excited to meet you guys as you guys are like seeing us. And she kind of said, I saw you come off Space Mountain. I couldn't get over to where you were. And so she'd actually seen me a couple of times in the park. Oh. But that was the first time she could like get to
you.
Where no. I was. Yeah. So she jokes like, I'm sorry, I'm kind of stalking you. I'm like, no, that's totally fine. Because, you know, in all reality, we put our faces out there on social media. We put our voices and we put our opinions out for mm-hmm. all the world to hear. So you're not being, you know, you're not being weird if you come up because you recognize us. It has been taking some getting used to since it's a podcast and it's mostly voice. A lot of you probably might not know what we look like. Mm-hmm. So you may not know if you saw us in the park or not because you may not know what we look like, which, so that kind of was a little weird to me, was I couldn't really wrap my head around how people knew what I looked like. And I realized, oh yeah.
The weirdest part to me is, like, they feel like they know us because we every week talk about our opinions of things. And like, we talk about, you know, we talk about producer James, you talk about Vern, you know, we've talked about the exchange students we have and all this stuff. So I feel like if you listen to the podcast, cause I listen to some podcasts too, and you really feel like, you know, these people, because they're like, it's very intimate. They're talking in your ear. Mm-hmm, right. Mm-hmm. And 100 episodes now, like, yeah, you get a good picture of who these people are. The weird thing for me was like, it's so one-sided because, like, I don't know who these people are because
they are lovers of Disneyland. No, but what more do you need to know?
But what I mean is, like, they come up and they know us, yeah, but then, like, but I don't know what they look like. I don't know if it's that they listen to the podcast. I don't know if it's just some random person. You know what I mean? Like, so that's, I think, the weird thing is that it's so one-sided in the beginning.
It's still so amazing.
But once they start talking about it, it's great. Mm-hmm. But it's just, it's so different. It's a different type of relationship than you would have with anything else.
It's so cool, though.
Which brings us to the D23 Expo. Of course, we had tons of coverage on the D23 Expo.
It was a very overwhelming experience, but I am very glad that we did it. I feel like we learned a lot, and so we can Expo better next time.
Do you know what I just shared with Simone, our other exchange student who did not go with us to Disneyland? We talked about the $9 hot dogs.
Oh, the $9.
He could not understand or believe or why we would pay $9 for a hot dog.
We had no other option. And then we learned, oh no, we did have lots of other options. We just didn't know that they existed. So that is one thing, one big takeaway, mm-hmm, for me with the D23 Expo is you do not have to eat that Expo food and stand in line. The first day we stood in line, like, what, an hour and a half or something, mm-hmm, to get our food, which, mm-hmm, wasn't great.
No.
And then we had the $9 hot dog. Yeah, so, but then later we figured, oh, there's all these great restaurants right outside the Expo Center, like right outside the Expo Arena.
Was it Blaze Pizza?
Yeah, Blaze Pizza.
Blaze Pizza's amazing. Oh,
so, so good.
And Earl of Sandwich.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, that's a little bit further.
One thing, too, that these 100 of episodes have done, other than create this great community around us, is it has allowed us, through your support, for us to be able to go to the parks together. Teresa and I have known each other 10 years. 10 years. And we have loved Disneyland for 10 years. But together, like she knew I loved Disneyland and I knew she loved Disneyland. We had, for whatever reason, we never made it to the parks together until this podcast.
Yes.
So you guys have helped us attain like a goal that we had not attained ourselves. And the fact that Teresa has an annual pass right now and was able to go twice in this month.
To me, by the way.
Amazing that you guys were able to support us so we could do that. As we get up in supporters, we're getting to a point where I might be able to get an annual pass. We might have to make another trip. So we'll see how this goes. I know producer James is going to send me to Disneyland, but I cannot take any money.
Nope, no money.
No
nothing.
Money.
I also want to say that here's a good question. This is going to be my question for you, James, and Teresa, and I'll answer it too. So 100 episodes in, where do you see us at 100 episodes from now?
Oh, boy.
James?
That's a tough one because
hopefully we would have gone to the parks once.
What? Just one time in 100 more episodes.
No,
I didn't even know you guys were going to get to 100 episodes. Like,
really?
I'm pretty impressed that you've been able to stick through it and the community has grown as well to really like give you a purpose behind wanting to keep doing this beyond just having someone to talk about your love of the Disney parks, in particular Disneyland, with. So I'm thankful as the significant other in this trio that's talking today that there is someone that you can talk to about Disneyland, so it's not always me.
But and yet you are wrangled into the episode every week.
I know. What can
I say? And when we're at the park without you, you're doing the episode without us.
Yeah. What can I say? I've grown to like this.
Yeah, we got to get producer James to the park at some point again because he really kind of missed out this time. But it was his job. It wasn't anything else. It was just his job. Yeah. Oh, well. Teresa, 100 episodes from now? Do you think we'll do this for 100 more episodes?
Oh, I'll be doing it.
Well, that means I'm going to be doing it. Yeah, our listeners have said.
You need to edit it because I don't know how to do that. You guys, I wish I could have recorded me trying to figure out how to use our portable recorder last week.
She called me in a panic.
When I was with Alex because I was very nervous that it didn't work.
I can hear it. I think it recorded. I don't know. Is that all I had to do? Yes.
100% tag is like the brains behind actually creating the podcast and like getting it out to you to listen. If it were up to me, I guess it would be like a live stream or something that might be as good as I can do. So you get to listen to all those bloopers. But I'm kind of with James. Like, it's so mind-boggling to me to think, well, almost 2 years ago now, the first time that you came, he came over
with more than two years.
Of this podcast equipment,
mm-hmm.
which I don't even know. Like, he did all this research, found all, like, these are the best mics, these are this, these are that. And mm-hmm. I have, as you guys may know, I have a very busy life. I have a full-time job, plus I have three kind of side jobs, too. So I've got a lot going on. So he used to come over to my house, and we'd record, and then he'd go home and then do all this work for it. And so really, my big thing was just having to be present for the recording part. I remember sitting in my kitchen or around my kitchen table thinking, I mean, this is fun, but is anyone really going to listen? And like I said earlier, like I legitimately thought the first time we got a $10 patron, I thought the person may have made a mistake and I wanted to reach out to them to make sure that they understood that they had supported us at the $10 level. Cause that was just like incredible to me that somebody enjoyed what we were doing that much to want to support us at that level. It's just crazy. And now we have over 100 supporters, which again is just mind-boggling to me. So I don't know what it's gonna like. I would not have thought we would have grown this much in our first 100 episodes. So I mean, sky's the limit, I guess, for our next 100 episodes.
100 episodes from now, I don't know. That's probably another 2 years, because if we keep up like we have been, we take the holidays off for Christmas and New Year's. I think that hopefully we will go to the park more frequently than we have the last 2 years. Yep. And I hope that by episode 200, we attain, it's our goal together, but I feel like you're the person who's going to make it happen of getting on the Disney media list.
Oh, yes.
Because I know that's something that you've been wanting to do.
I think that'd be amazing. Amazing.
A highlight of the last 100 episodes was going to the D23 Expo and having the Disneyland ambassador say he's listened to our show and to keep trying because you will eventually get on the list.
Yes, that was very cool. I wish our photos with him would have turned out better. I was actually looking at those today. I wish the lighting in the area that we were in was all sorts of, it was very cool.
It was the Disney Parks Pavilion that they had all the,
so they had like darker lighting, but like blue lights and all that. So it didn't make for the prime place to have a photo taken. No. The other like super cool thing, and then I'll move on. Super cool thing was when we were in the parks and saw the Disneyland ambassador walking up Main Street as we were walking down. Mm-hmm. We made eye contact and we're like, hey, like we were old friends. That was really like just amazing. I do think it's really cool too when we were there to know so many other people in the parks. And so we'd be waiting in line for one attraction. We'd look over and we'd see like, oh, look, there's Kate. Hey, Kate. You know, mm-hmm. to have like friends that were also in the park at the same time and like to kind of wave and like meet up with them and all that. That was just very, very cool.
Yeah, definitely. If you guys haven't guessed, the thing that I think has been the best for all of us on the 100 episodes is all of you guys.
The listeners, yes. Yeah. Our weekly tiers.
Yeah. So thank you guys. As much as you think that we do stuff for you, putting out this podcast every week, you guys give us the mm-hmm. motivation and the stuff to keep doing it every week. And when there's been times where audio hasn't been great, or we've been really busy and we have to throw together something quick because we have to get the episode out, it's you guys that made us persevere through all of that. Mm-hmm. So once again, thank you guys so much. You guys are all amazing. And here's to another 100 episodes, hopefully. All right. So the first thing that we have today is we have a question or some feedback that came in. And I thought that there was quite a few people who might actually appreciate the answers to some of this stuff. So Baron from Albuquerque, New Mexico, emailed in and said, hello, Tig and Teresa. First off, thanks for the regular dose of Disneyland that brightens up my Wednesday afternoons each week. Keep up the great work. Admittedly, I stopped listening to last week's episode about midway through only because of potential spoilers related to the Oogie Boogie Bash. My wife and stepdaughter and I are headed to Disneyland October 9th and 11th, and we'll be at the Oogie Boogie Bash at DCA on the afternoon or evening of the 10th. We're all extremely excited, but have been very keen to not get out on the internet and have some of the spooky surprises that await us spoiled. That being said, Teresa, having experienced the Oogie Boogie Bash, is there anything that you wish you would have known ahead of time? Let's start there.
Overall, I had a very positive experience of the Oogie Boogie Bash, so it's hard for me to like say, well, I wish I would have known this one thing. The one thing I wish I would have known ahead of time was where exactly my seating area for the reserve seating for the Frightfully, or excuse me, the reserved area, because it was supposed to be standing. They did allow us to sit because it wasn't packed full. I wish I would have known where that was.
Where was that?
More specifically. So it was kind, it was by the Blue Cellar.
The Blue Sky Cellar.
Yeah, Blue Sky Cellar thing. So it was, in my opinion, on the wrong curve of a corner that you want to be sitting when you watch a Halloween park or when you watch any parade. I like to be able to look down the road and watch the parade as it's coming towards me. Where we were, we just kind of saw it after it turned the corner and like there was the float.
Sure.
So I didn't feel like I got to see the parade and experience the parade how I wanted to see it. However, my parents that were sitting across the way from me had like the perfect viewing spot. And so I almost jumped ship and like went over and stood next to them. So I wish I would have known that. I do think that that has kind of come out more so, that a lot of people have talked about how they weren't very happy with that dining package. I do want to say, though, the food was excellent. I have never eaten.
They look good.
At the Wine Country Trattoria before, but it was excellent. So I just think of that experience as the dining experience. And the parade, I mean, it's not that long of a parade, so I don't feel like I missed out too much. It just wasn't exactly what I wanted, if that makes sense.
So is there something that would have made things easier or more enjoyable is the next question.
Some things that would have made it easier or more enjoyable.
Is there something that would have made it easier?
So what enjoyable? I would suggest doing is when you get into DCA, they are going to give you a map. So I would kind of take some time, look at that map. Since you don't really know what there is, look at all the different things, figure out what's important to you and to your family to experience. Because unfortunately, there is so much going on, which is awesome, but there just is not enough time to get everything done. So if they want to focus on attractions and riding attractions, then there's your focus. My focus was going on the immersive treat trails and checking out Villains Grove and then the nighttime show of Villainous, the World of Color show. So those are the things that I really focused on. So I kind of made a mental plan as to like what made most sense going, you know, how to attack the park, I guess would be a good way of saying it. The other thing too, I don't know if you guys are annual pass holders or not, but keep in mind that there is a special trail dedicated just to annual pass holders that is back by Goofy's Sky School. I found a good time to go back to that treat trail was actually right after the Frightfully Fun Parade. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people ran back there first. So I did hear that lines could be pretty long back at the AP treat trail, but my experience was pretty good. And the other thing that I was surprised about too, there are two showings of Villainous, the World of Color show, which was great because then if you got distracted, it wasn't like, oh, dang it, I missed it.
Sure.
You know, or if you had just gotten into this one section that you've been waiting to get into, you know, that's fine. But I was surprised we did the earlier showing and it was actually not as packed as I thought it was going to be. The one thing I kind of had to wrap my head around after the Oogie Boogie Bash, which I wish I would have realized before, it's a ticketed event, so there is not as many people in the park as like a regular park day would be.
Sure.
So even like, so I was really worried about viewing areas for both the parade and for World of Color, but I didn't feel like after we did it, I didn't feel like we needed to have the reserved area because my parents that walked up at the same time we did got great seating, no problem. World of Color, we actually were walking past it on our way to something else and we stopped and realized that it wasn't really that full. And we walked over and got great seats for the World of Color Villainous show. So that kind of took a little bit of, I don't know, it kind of took a little bit off of it. The other thing too that I would suggest, don't let the lines intimidate you. The lines at points can look crazy long, but they do move them through pretty fast. So it's worth it. Plus, once you get into the treat trail areas, especially the immersive ones, there's a lot going on. There's a lot to see. So you'll kind of enjoy having the longer line so that you can take it all in.
So anything that would have made your time spent at the bash more efficient and or effective? I think you kind of just covered that. So
yeah.
So what you're saying is, so like when it comes to things like Villainous and the Frightfully Fun Parade, can you just kind of like decide, can you arrive right when it starts and get a decent seat? Like, maybe don't spend a bunch of time waiting for something?
I would say so, because the other thing too that you have to remember is these areas, these parade routes, and this the viewing area for World of Color is set up to hold way more people than what the Oogie Boogie Bash allowed in the doors. So there's a ton of space. It just depends on if you would prefer to be standing or sitting on the curb or sitting on a bench. Then, of course, you do have to go over a little sooner. Maybe if there's somebody in your party that doesn't mind just relaxing and hanging out for a bit, they can kind of secure a primo spot for you.
So one question Baron didn't ask, but I think it's a good one, is if there was one thing that you would say do not miss, what would it be?
I can't choose one thing because I loved all everything.
Okay, is there anything that like
don't
you could put at the end of your list, in your opinion?
I would not waste my time personally with any of the treat trails that were not immersive. I really enjoyed going to the 4 treat trails that do have villains hosting them. Very, very cool. There's a ton of goodie drop spots at those. I did not feel like I was short on candy or goodies and treats at all, even though I technically only did 4 treat trails. So I think a lot of other people were going back to other areas of the park. Pixar Pier has stuff going on. Cars Land has stuff going on. They don't have any of the quote-unquote immersive treat trails there. They're just regular treat trails.
Sure.
So if getting a lot of candy is your thing, by all means, hit up as many treat trails as you possibly can. But for me, the villains treat trails were definitely worthwhile.
Well, Baron, I hope that answers your question. I hope you guys have a great time. Let us know what your party experience was like when you get back.
Well, and I just want to let you know, Baron, the things that I focused on were I did not do any attractions. I focused on the immersive treat trails. I focused on Villainous, which is the World of Color show, and also Villains Grove. Very, very cool. If I could do something differently, I would have made time to go through Villains Grove twice instead of just once, because I really didn't want to leave back there. It was so cool.
I also really want to see this, so hopefully.
I hope that helps.
Yeah. Well, if you enjoyed the show, please leave a review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to the show. By leaving a review, it helps get our ranking better and allows the community to grow.
Well, we hope you enjoyed listening to this episode of DL Weekly. You can support the show for as little as 25 cents an episode. If you want access to the supporter chat that we always talk about, it's just 75 cents an episode. So please consider joining supporters like Jeanette H. and head on over to dlweekly.net/support.
Well, now it's time to return to James and Trivia Land to get the answers to this week's trivia, which is all about our 100 episodes. Well, 99 up until this point, I guess.
Yeah, I didn't really know what this episode entailed, so it was kind of hard to come up with trivia ahead of time. So.
Sure.
Well, those would have been give-me's, too.
That's true. All right, so our first question this week was, what episodes did producer James and producer Vern debut? And Teresa, you had the discussion topic correct, but the episode was titled Pixar Pier is Finally Here.
That's cute.
And Tag, you have me coming in way too early. I showed up as episode 24, Disney is Cutting Down the Rainforest Cafe.
Which was one of the most listened to episodes for a long time.
Longest time.
That's right, because that was part of our DCA tour, wasn't it?
Yes. Because we did pick, well.
And what episode was Vern? What number?
37.
24 and 37.
Yeah, so not too much after. Question number two is, when did you two start this podcast together? And great minds come together to come up with the right answer. Your first episode was indeed September 20th, 2017.
Good job, Teresa. All the credit for that one.
Just a little over 2 years and you hit 100 episodes. That's pretty good. That means you're pretty consistent every week. So.
We try. We only take the holiday off, basically.
Pretty much. So question number three was, other than the tour of the park, what is the longest episode? And you were both not on track with this one. It was actually episode 56. Disneyland to Disney World questions answered, because you spent a lot of time talking about nighttime spectaculars as well as answering listener questions.
Didn't we have concierge on for that too?
Mm-hmm.
I think so. So that one clocked in at 2 hours and 20 minutes. So that was definitely a good one to listen to if you have a long commute.
Wow.
Our fourth question was, how many episode titles relate to Halloween? And we're going to give Teresa a point for being just one off 9 episode titles relate to Halloween. So you're definitely on the right track thinking that we talk about Halloween a lot here. And our last one, approximate total time of normal podcast episodes that we've had of the first 99. And with a little bit of rounding, we're going to give Tag a point. It is just over 100 hours of content, about 6,025 minutes. Give or take a couple.
So those people that go back and listen to our episodes, they listen to 100 over a little over 100 hours of us.
They can spend
4 days listening to you, not including your bonus, your feedbacks, and other episodes. Yeah.
You guys are crazy. So, I can't believe we've spent 100 hours talking.
We've spent over 100 hours talking.
It's crazy.
Because like you said, that wasn't bonus episodes.
Well, think of how many hours I've spent editing.
A lot.
Yeah.
Thankfully, less now. We don't have as many bloopers, except for tonight. I had quite a few.
Yeah, I don't know what was up with that.
Black asleep.
Yeah, so congratulations on making it to 100 episodes and a past 100 hours. Here's to the next 100 of both. Next week, we'll see if we come back to normal trivia or if we find another theme to go with. But either way, I look forward to having some listener questions to add into the mix. I've got some great ones on hold already, but I'd love to keep on adding some good ones to that as well. You can send me an email. It's trivia@dlweekly.net.
We will be back next week with more Disneyland news and information.
So until then, go out and enjoy the parks.